Hi, I'm James Bruce, hardware reviews editor for MakeUseOf.com, and I'm back. It's February 2019, so I want to do an update on our VR buying guide. Right now, we are in a very difficult place when it comes to making recommendations about which VR headset to buy. Now, in the past, this has largely been a question of HTC Vive or Oculus Rift. However, there are some new headsets on the way, some of which we know for sure about, some of which are only rumors, but all of which may be complete game changers. And while this makes for a very exciting time to be in the VR world, it does make it very difficult to recommend something to buy. So before I begin, I'm not going to talk about PlayStation VR. It's cheap, decent enough. However, the headset and the controller tracking is really subpar. But that said, you do have a good library of exclusives on the PlayStation, so you're bound to get some enjoyment out of it. Apart from which, if you don't have a PC to play tethered VR on, well then, a PlayStation is your next best thing. So, if you have a PS4, buy a PSVR. If you do decide you love VR and really want to upgrade your system, then save up for a decent gaming PC, and then once you've done that, come back here and we'll figure out which headset you should buy. In this video, I'm really going to talk about PC VR headsets, with one minor exception. So what's out there at the moment? Well, on the lower end of PC VR, you have a plethora of Windows mixed reality headsets, all at a really nice budget price point of around $150 to $300. Now, these are strictly VR headset, there's no mixed reality about them, so don't be fooled by the name. And when you're looking around for a deal, make sure that you're buying one that comes with tracked controllers. Some of them don't, they're sold as just the headset, but you are going to want the controllers too, so don't be fooled into thinking it's super cheap, because it may not come with controllers, and that'll be another $100 extra. The Windows mixed reality uses two cameras at the front of the headset, which look around your environment. Now, this makes it really easy to set up room scale tracking for the headset itself. However, the controller tracking can be a little bit iffy. In most of the cases, this isn't going to matter. However, if you pull your controllers out of sight of the headset, it'll freeze in place and revert to rotational tracking like that. Now, in most cases, this won't be a problem. In games like Rec Room, for instance, if you want to pick up a weapon, you can reach down and sort of point roughly in the direction of it and it'll still work. However, for more advanced, maybe military sim games like Onward, it can be an issue and your controllers will lose tracking as you try to reach down, touch something or pick it up. Still, as I said, the setup is really super simple. You don't need anything in the corner of your room, so they definitely have that advantage if you're going to be taking it around and demoing it to people. In addition, they're actually slightly higher resolution than the Vive or the Oculus Rift. And although I was trying to start off this buying guide at the lower end of the price scale, there are in fact higher end Windows mixed reality headsets as well, like the Samsung Odyssey Plus. Unfortunately, that's only available in the US, so I haven't had a chance to test that. However, it has a significantly higher resolution, the same as the Vive Pro, in fact, and has been getting some pretty good reviews. The tracking limitations on the controller are still present, but it's definitely a more reasonable price point at around $500. So definitely worth considering if you can go and experience one in the shops and give it a go yourself. Then we have the Oculus Rift and the HTC Vive, which out of the box have roughly the same experience nowadays. They're both the same resolution, they both have roughly the same field of view, though the tracking systems and the controllers are pretty different. The Oculus Rift is now $350, whilst the basic Vive package is $500. However, for the Oculus Rift, you're probably going to want an additional tracking camera, perhaps some USB controllers and additional extension cables, so that's going to add another $100. And on the Vive, you're almost certainly going to want the deluxe audio strap, which is again another $100. So think of it as around $500 for the Oculus Rift or $600 for the HTC Vive. Now, those are both complete packages, which include the tracking cameras or the sensor base stations, as well as the controllers. However, it is worth pointing out that both the Oculus Rift and the HTC Vive are around 2 years old at this point. And though I wouldn't quite call them outdated, I do feel they're going to be superseded by something better very soon. Oculus is rumored to be releasing a slightly better version of the Rift S, while the Vive already has the Vive Pro model out, and there may be something else coming soon. That's not to say if you buy an HTC Vive or an Oculus Rift that they'll be outdated as soon as you buy them. Just bear in mind they are sort of coming to the end of their life cycle. So the experiences that you'll have with the Oculus Rift or the HTC Vive are largely similar. It really comes down to comfort and which controller you're going to prefer. The Oculus Rift controllers are considered to be the most technically advanced ones that you can get. They're very ergonomic and the buttons have capacitive sensors on them, so the system can tell when you're pointing your finger or when you've raised your thumb up. The HTC Vive ones, on the other hand, are a bit clunkier. They have this annoying trackpad in the middle and they're quite a lot heavier. That said, which controller you prefer largely comes down to personal preference. Personally, I find the Oculus controllers to be a little bit small, and after a while my hands tend to cramp up a bit when using them. I don't really like grabbing onto things with this button on the side. For most of the games I play, it tends to be something where I'm holding a gun, a rifle or a sword, something like that. So I actually prefer the added heft of the Vive ones. It feels a lot more realistic, like I'm holding something chunky in my hands. In an ideal world, I'd be able to use one Oculus Rift controller in this hand and a big clunky Vive controller in this hand, but there you go. Also, if you can afford it, there is a Vive wireless upgrade for around $300. And I have to say that taking the cable away is a massive difference. Once you've played without a cable, it's very difficult to go back to playing with one. There is a wireless solution available for the Oculus Rift, but it's really not very good. It's a bit complicated to set up. This is official, so it's basically plug and play. In terms of tracking quality, once you've got them both set up, they're pretty much identical. However, if you do have a very large room, the HTC Vive is going to serve you better than the Oculus Rift. And although it's not quite as rocky as the first year in which the Oculus Rift launched, the fact that the Oculus Rift requires a bunch of USB ports for the tracking cameras can cause problems for some people. The HTC Vive's base stations are passive laser emitters. They only require power in order to work. They don't need to connect to the computer at all. However, one other point worth mentioning is that there are a lot of horror stories around about HTC support. So if your Vive does ever break down and you need to contact support, you may have to wait months only to be told that it suffered from water damage and then pay for a repair anyway. It's a pretty horrific situation. Perhaps we are only seeing the horror stories though and not the stories of good customer service, but the fact that you don't get all those horror stories about Oculus support speaks volumes. Now, I've been lucky in that I had a day one pre-order for the HTC Vive, and in those 2 years, it hasn't broken. It's still chugging along just fine, but you might not be so lucky. On the other hand, it can also be a question of luck with getting the Oculus Rift set up correctly. Not all USB extension cables will work. You may find you're having to check the Oculus subreddit wiki to find which cables are compatible. You may find your motherboard's USB ports just aren't good enough, and you may have to buy a separate controller card. You'll almost certainly need to buy an extra camera if you need to track a larger space. On the other hand, it may work fine right out of the box for you. Things have certainly improved a lot since the Rift was first launched. I had a lot of trouble getting it working initially, but now they've improved the setup routines a lot. It's certainly not as bad as it was, and a lot of the things are now known information. You can find out and people will be able to help you. Also, if money is no object, then do look at the Vive Pro. It has the best resolution around, the best tracking around, and it's compatible with the wireless upgrade. But a full setup like that is going to cost you around $1,500, I think, which is a lot to ask for what you're getting. So only buy that if money is really no object. So that's pretty much your current choices when it comes to the current crop of VR headsets. But this is going to be a difficult one because, as I said, there's a couple of headsets right around the corner that you really should know about before buying anything right now. So first is the Pimax 5K and 8K, Chinese-made headsets which are a part of the Valve ecosystem. So they use the Valve lighthouses for tracking, same as the Vive, and the same ones as the Vive. The main selling point of the new Pimax headset is the massively increased field of view. Now, the current generation of headsets like the Oculus Rift and the HTC Vive have around 100 to 110 degree horizontal field of view. So that essentially looks like you're viewing the VR world through a pair of ski goggles. The Pimax headsets are promising up to 200 degrees, which is roughly twice what we get now. Now, there are compromises. For that much of a field of view, you are going to get significant distortion due to the lenses, but you can also configure it for not quite as wide, say 150 degree field of view, which is still a significant upgrade and one which you'll get less distortion around the edges for. But one other thing to bear in mind is that in order to render that additional field of view, you will need a significantly more powerful graphics processor. We're talking 1080 Ti as a bare minimum to run these things. So although they're in production now and due for release very soon, probably within the next month or so, it'll start shipping to the Kickstarters. You're probably going to need to save up for a new graphics card anyway. And the price for the headset alone of the Pimax 5K Plus, which is going to be the most popular choice, I think, is $700. That's just for the headset alone. You're going to need a full set of base stations and controllers as well. So initially it's going to be pitched as an upgrade for Vive owners. At a later stage, they will produce their own controllers and base stations as well. I would expect that to cost around $1,200-ish. It really could be a game changer, possibly the headset of choice for high-end PC VR gaming. Then we also have rumors of a secret project by Valve themselves, owners of the Steam platform and creators of the Steam VR ecosystem. Now, not a lot is known about it at the moment. However, there have been leaks of images and there is definitely a headset on the way. That much we can pretty much be sure of. Now, whether it's going to be produced by Valve themselves or handed off to a third-party company like HTC was with the Vive, we don't know. It is expected to launch alongside the new Knuckles controllers, which are a lot like the Rift controllers, only they have a strap attaching to your wrist, meaning that you'll be able to let go of them completely, emulate throwing something. And in addition, it's expected to perhaps launch alongside some first party games from Valve, which will almost certainly be something in the Half-Life universe. So there's no timeline for this. We really don't have much more information than that, but it is definitely coming and it's something to look out for. If not being released this year, then at least being announced and being produced and sold next year. Finally, it's worth talking about the Oculus Quest. Now, this isn't a PC headset. I know I said I'd focus almost entirely on PC headsets, but this is the one exception. It's a high-end mobile all-in-one headset featuring positional tracking for both the headset and the two motion controls it will come with. And we already know the price of $400, with the launch date expected to be the Facebook F8 conference this year. So right now, the Oculus mobile headset is the Oculus Go, which pretty much supersedes Gear VR. It's an all-in-one mobile solution, but it doesn't have positional tracking, and this controller's, well, it's not great. It's a pointer. However, this has no positional tracking, it's rotational only, so it's basically only good for watching movies rather than proper VR gaming. So the Oculus Quest, on the other hand, will have fully tracked controllers using the same sort of method as the Windows Mixed Reality headset, and then it'll have some cameras on the front of the device, which then look around at the surroundings and the controllers. So the Oculus Quest is expected to launch with a bunch of titles that cross over with the Rift. Not too graphically intensive, but things like Rec Room, for instance, should work fine on the Oculus Quest and will likely feature crossplay with Rift users as well. So these are still fully interactive, proper VR experiences on a single $400 complete all-in-one headset. Personally, I can't wait. Yes, it'll be simplistic graphics, but it'll bring VR to the masses. Let's face it, PC VR can still be quite frustrating and does need a high-end gaming PC, which not everyone can afford. At $400 all in for the complete package, it's going to be an absolute bargain. So I'm really hyped for that, particularly for the wider scale room tracking that they had going on. In fact, they demoed it with arena scale tracking, with multiple players inside the same large open space. So to answer the question, which headset should you buy or should you wait? Really, it depends how desperate you are to get into VR and how much disposable income you have at the moment. If you're okay with dropping $400 and then upgrading again in a year's time, then really you can't go wrong with either the Oculus Rift, the HTC Vive, or any of the mixed reality headsets right now. I can't tell you exactly which one to buy because it really is subjective and it comes down to personal preference. If you asked for my personal preference, well, I mostly play on the Vive every day simply because it's wireless and I prefer the controllers. If you wear large glasses, you may not be able to fit them inside the Oculus Rift. You could wear contact lenses, or you may not need glasses at all if you're long-sighted, but it's something to bear in mind, and that's exactly why I say you should go out and try all of the headsets yourself, see which ones you prefer. You'll find lots of places demoing them in shops or in local clubs or even just from friends. But do get out there and have a go on them before you decide which one to buy. If you have $400 to spend but can't afford a PC on top of that, then absolutely wait for the Oculus Quest. Yes, you aren't going to get fantastic graphics, but you will get a full VR experience and may even be able to cross-play certain games with your PC VR friends. I wouldn't say go out and buy a PlayStation just for the VR at the moment, but if you have a PlayStation, there is the PlayStation VR, you should buy that. If, however, you've scrimped and saved for years, you've now got your $500, your $1,000, and you're looking for something to buy, I hate to be the guy that says wait a bit longer, but you should probably wait a bit longer. At this point, you would be buying into VR sort of between generations. That's not to say you wouldn't get years of enjoyment still out of your Rift or your Vive or whatever if you bought now, but I suspect you'd get jealous very quickly of the newer headsets that are going to come, likely before the end of this year. So just hold out a few more months, wait for some more solid announcements on what's coming, and in the meantime, I would strongly advise playing through that library of Steam games that you bought in the sale, because once you get VR, you will never touch flat games again. Anyway, that's it from me. I hope I've helped you to make a decision about which headset to buy, or even if not to buy and to wait. I am always excited for the next great bit of technology to come along, but I'm also so thankful to have been a part of the VR revolution so far that started so many years ago now. For a bit of context, this is my Oculus DK1. At the time that was delivered from the Kickstarter, there was a whopping two things you could load onto it. One was a roller coaster and the other one was the Tuscany Villa. Ah, I remember thee well. The point is, we've come so far since then, and there's so much further to go. Anyway, until next time, maybe I'll see you in the metaverse.